Show. I'm Cav Manning from the Lingus Mafia podcast. All my nonsense is at Lingus Mafia, and I am joined, of course, by Mr. Billy Body, the leader in all of your pro wrestling news. Good morning, Billy.
Yeah, morning.
Oh, man, I'm fucking tired. I was like, you know what? We should be doing this in the afternoons. I'm always fucking tired still.
Well, I mean, if it was really good, and we needed to be like super energetic about it, I'm like, consider moving. I considered like moving it to Saturdays, didn't I? To make Raw 6 days late and SmackDown the next day, as it is the better show at the moment.
Yeah, it is the better show. And last night, so to tell people, I get this new mixing board, and I decide to, it's like a kid at Christmas. I got this new toy. I want to check it out right away. So I'm opening it. But at the same time, I'm trying to take notes for Raw. And that's how entertaining Raw is, that I'm like, I turn around and I go, okay, this is the match. And I write it down. And I'm like, I could give two fucks about what happens. I don't know what happens. So we're going to go through everything. And I will tell everybody what we have. We were going to go through SmackDown first, of course. And that starts off with the 10 bell salute for Pat Patterson. I'm only bothered that they pipe in fake thank you, Pat chants. I mean, nobody's there. You don't need to. I mean, it's very artificial to me.
I don't think people would have shouted thank you, Pat, even if they were there.
I wonder, that seems like something that would be, but that's like, you know, the smart fan that knows, you know, Pat did stuff to contribute, and thank you for that.
Exactly.
Yeah, see, that is a good point, you know, I wonder. But yeah, anything piped in, and the same thing with thank you, Taker, when he was there. Let's pipe it in. I mean, I don't know, I find that to be fucking awful. Interview in the ring with Roman and Jay and Paul. They're all in the ring. Owen shows up and says, let's do this at TLC for the title. Roman says, we're having this tag match tonight. I'm a gentleman. I'm not going to beat on you right now like I would back in the day. Owen says, grow a pair of balls because you're a bitch. And Roman just keeps walking very stoically.
It's a bit better than how you've said it, but
okay, what do you find good about this? Go for it. I mean, obviously, I think these are the best storylines they have, is anything with Roman. So
it's the detail that you're missing out, where he turns around and says that, where he first of all challenges for the match, and he turns around and says, let's fight right now. And he goes, I'm not going to do it right now. He goes, there's a woman in the ring. Goes, grow up. And adds those two lines in where he just says there's a woman in the ring and tells him to grow up. And it's kind of like Owens does look bad here. Like, it does look like Owens. It is a good get. Roman loses nothing here by getting out of it, because it's you know, when anyone tells you in any situation to grow up, I've said it to like girlfriends before. Yeah. I would say it to that psychopath all the time. I'd be like, grow up. I'm at home. Grow up. I'm going to play tennis. Grow up. Or whatever. I just tucked it in there on the end of where, of questioning where I was, where I actually was. You probably worked out. But yeah, that I think added to it. It wasn't just a case of, I'm not doing it now. It was a case of, I'm not doing it now because of this reason that, you know, he doesn't really care about, but has like some validity to it. Just the sort of inner subtleties of this makes me really think that it's not written by the same people that write everything else, where there are like no subtleties at all. Like even with like the whole thing with Drew and Sheamus on the other side, they're hammering into your fucking brain. It's like they're friends. They're like these drinking buddy friends who like fight together, and they've been friends for years and years. They didn't convey it in any kind of organic way. They had to hit you over the head with it because you're a stupid wrestling fan. You're not a smart wrestling fan because you'd be listening to the other podcast, the smart wrestling fans. You're a stupid
if you haven't been blocked or have time.
Yeah. So you're here listening to this show with me and Cav. So you're a stupid wrestling fan. You need to be held over the head. But this Roman thing is not for stupid wrestling fans. This is like something from a real TV show where it has subtleties and believability and, more sensationally, good acting.
Mm-hmm.
Good acting, which I'm going to point out throughout the show, bad acting. But I'll start by pointing out the good acting so we have some semblance of balance. But anyway, that's what I wanted to say.
Speaking of bad acting, Natalia versus Bayley and Bianca Belair on commentary. Natty wins fucking clean by tap out. And Bianca has nothing to do with it. There was nothing she did that caused this to happen. And then Bianca stands there and applauds and does that hand slap thing.
Yeah, like a fish. It's so weird that like Bayley went to this. Like, yeah, I mean, she was like the champion. It's like people obviously, you know, throughout wrestling, people have gone down the card. But, you know, I didn't think she would be people that got that lose a title and go down the card like Kofi. She's Kofi right now.
Yeah, it was. And I'm wondering, I mean, I was shocked by it. I guess they're like, okay, well, we need something new. But I mean, they're building up
Bianca, like Bianca and Bayley is the feud, but you still need some wins for that.
And I thought maybe, like, you know, there'd be the distraction by Bianca causing this. It's just flat out, she fucking gets tapped out. So I'm like, okay, well, I don't know. I mean, you're being made fun of afterwards. I guess that's the thing. I don't know. Pat Patterson tribute, they're showing tweets, and then they have a video tribute. I thought this was nice. I felt actually sad seeing this because, you know, he's one of those guys that you've seen growing up. And, you know, it's almost like that extended family thing when somebody dies that you've seen on TV for a long time. So, I mean, I liked Pat, and we all know, you know, the genius that he was and how much he did. So, I thought it was very, very nice. Pat Patterson tribute match. This is where I have a fucking problem. Do you have the same problem as I do? I appreciate the sentiment, a tribute, but what the fuck is this? A 6-man tag team match. Because it has former IC champions in it? Fucking Brian, Big E, Mysterio versus Shane. I mean, Ziggler, Shinsuke, and Sammy. Well, how is this a tribute to fucking Pat? Just because they all had the IC title at one time?
I think that is the tribute, yeah.
Yeah, that's retarded, is what this is. They should have had an IC fucking tournament then or something. Fucking tribute. Fucking let's have a tag team match. Jesus Christ. Brian, small package on Sammy. Cole starts screaming that that's a Pat Patterson quick one. I assume Pat would, when he would tell finishes, that this was one of his finishes. Like, there's a Dusty finish, this is a Pat finish, a catch him quick. Or was that how he would talk about his dates? A quick finish. He just finished.
I didn't have as big a problem with it. I mean, they tried to... At the end of it, that thing with Ziggler, they did an atomic drop, which is gone. I assume this was, I've never seen a Pat Patterson match. I only know him as a road agent and booker. Yeah. So this is my problem with this whole thing later when we get to Raw. It's all fire and do the tribute here. Tribute match, weird thing to do. I don't know why it had to be this. And then you had the old Intercontinental title out there as well. Do you know he didn't even win this Intercontinental title? It was just a made-up tournament they had. And they just get. That's the other thing about it.
Yeah, that's the little Iggy where they kind of have a fucking wink to it, you know, that he won a tournament in Rio de Janeiro that there never was. I guess he was just, it was Triple H getting the world title. Here you go. Yeah, the whole Gaga stuff, as Pat would say, with the Ziggler, with the atomic drop. He's even holding his ears when he gets hit with the atomic drop. That's how much it got him in the ass. And, you know, of course, he falls down to get the 619, and then Big E puts his finisher on him. Okay, got it. Owens interview in the back. He says he's mad at Roman because he was such a good guy before, and now he's a dick. Kalisto walks through the interview. I think that's Kalisto. I don't even know if that's him or not. And Owens is like, oh, we're in the middle of an interview. And he's like, sorry. And he goes, that's okay. Nice hat. And he walks away. What the fuck is going on?
In what sense?
What? Why? What happened? Is this a fucking accident? With Kalisto?
I don't think I've seen what you're talking about.
Oh, my God. You're going to have to see this. Owens is doing an interview, and Kalisto walks through a door behind him. And he's like, oh, sorry. And he's like, that's okay. I'm in an interview. And he's like, he goes, nice hat. And he goes, thanks. And then he walks away. In the middle of the interview, there is nothing to do with this.
Who's wearing a hat?
Kalisto. He's wearing a fedora over his fucking mask. And Owen says, nice fedora. And Kalisto goes, what's a fedora?
Yeah, it seems like too much talking to be an accident. It seems like if someone had done it, it would have just walked in, shot, and ran off.
Yeah. There is zero reason for any of this. Otis walks in and, you know, hey, we're going to do it tonight. You know, okay. More Pat tribute with tweets. Carmella and Sasha do an interview from separate places. Which one are you fucking?
How difficult. I don't think Sasha looked her best here. Plus, she was quite. I don't think this was her best talk. This is not her strength here to talk in these segments, because Carmella was better at it.
I mean,
you know, if I can't see Sasha's. It's very weird. Like, usually it'd be Sasha easily, but that's all down to it's down to the way she walks down to the ring and conducts herself here.
She lives by the outfit.
Yeah, this was just her head and talking. And I mean, Carmella hasn't got the best face. I wouldn't look at Carmella and go, oh yeah, she's got the best face.
Sure.
But I think she was better here. I don't know why.
She's got the better body.
Who, Carmella?
Yeah.
Yeah, so she should win every category against Sasha, but I don't know why she doesn't.
Yeah,
if you break it down, she should win in every category.
Sasha, I mean, we know with the titty thing, but when she wears these outfits, and there's certain looks where she looks really hot in the face too, and then Carmella, like you say, I mean, she's not an ugly girl, obviously, but she's not that glam model face that you want. But that's the funny thing, because you go, okay, well, let's go face wise. But that's where Sasha always has had her not so strong suit, depending on, you know, how they film her. I mean,
it is weird. Like I always say, when it comes down to wrestling or any kind of familiarity that you build with someone, you can watch a TV show. Say, for example, you're watching Cobra Kai, mm-hmm. and there's characters on there. Obviously, not a lot of them are teenage girls, but there's one, the character Tori, who they introduced in series two. Because you've seen her character on there, you'll follow her Instagram and her stuff, and you're interested to see what her real name is, Peyton List, and you're interested to see what else she does, and you're really intrigued by her. And it was the same when, what was her name? Fuck. Who's the lead in the Hunger Games? She's a really famous actress, and I forgot.
Oh, yeah. I've never seen Hunger Games, but I know the face of the girl. Yeah. I couldn't tell you her name.
Is it Jennifer Lawrence?
I think that might be it.
Okay. So that's the thing. Like, when you see the character in the Hunger Games, you're interested in seeing her more of, I think, the girl from Tomb Raider, who was the last Tomb Raider. She'd done, like, some movies where there were some sex scenes, and I, like, you know, wanted to go and check those out. It's, again, it's like the familiarity of with the character. Yeah, you can go through a million porns and find someone that you're introduced to that second. And, yeah, she'll be, like, really hot. But there's no fascination there to watch her get banged. Because your familiarity with her is about 2 seconds. Like, you were looking for a scene on Pornhub and you found it. Whereas when those page scenes came out, everybody went wild. Paige is not the best looking girl in the world or whatever. So this is the thing. With the familiarity that comes around, when you become familiar with people, they then do become not to the same extent, but it's like the girl when there's like a fairly hot girl at something that you regularly go to, be at gym or at work or wherever. Like, you would like to see that girl naked a lot more. Mm-hmm. Once you want to see a girl you work with naked far more than you do anybody you see on TV. It's just the way your brain works, right? So that's the same thing. It's all like levels here. So with Sasha, because you're seeing her every week and she's doing what she's doing on TV, there's more desire to see her. Like, there would, if she did anything sex tape wise, photo shoots, well, even if she did like a fucking cover of Maxim, like, say for example a men's magazine realized that a lot of men fancied Sasha Banks from wrestling and from Mandalorian or whatever, and she did a whole cover, it'd fucking sell like crazy. Like, we'd all go and buy it. And that's the thing. Like, Carmella doesn't have that. She hasn't been on TV doing this as of late, and it's the same in the same, really, my argument with Mandy Rose, Dana, all these people. Like, you say, like, Mandy Rose is this, that, and the other, but actually only when she was doing the skits where she was trying to fuck Jey Uso while he's with Naomi was the only time where I ever considered her in and around the top. Other than that, where she's just walking out and doing her whole like wrestling shtick, there's nothing to that at all. So yeah, so it's a weird one with Sasha because it's all character. It's all like character, and it still has to be that character in that outfit, because if some new girl come out wearing Sasha's outfit, it wouldn't work. It's all character and outfit. And I think over the last few weeks, we'll get to that in a minute, but I've kind of called off on Aaliyah Mysterio as well, because as she's continued to just walk down, she's not doing anything anymore. So that kind of calls it off.
You're not getting to know her.
No, exactly. She's just there. She's just walking down. So you'll call off on that as well. So yeah, I mean that's kind of like my and that's the other, and look at, and the perfect example is that all of a sudden Becky got a lot harder to people when she started getting over.
Mm-hmm.
How can that make any sense?
You know, you're spot on with all these about this whole thing. And you know what's funny? This is the most we've discussed the show. It's just by hotness of the women and who you'd bang more. That has been more discussion than the actual show.
I'm explaining like the psychological.
But it's true. Right? It all makes sense.
Because if you're sitting there and you're thinking on every metric, like, Carmella would be hotter than Sasha, but if you're given a choice, you still think more about Sasha Banks and you'd want to bang her more. This is why. This is why you're thinking that. This is me explaining how your head is thinking, how your head works. Very Not true. Yours, but anyone listening to this is probably thinking the same thing. Because in walking down the street, like, Sasha's walking next to Mandy, Sasha and Mandy walk into a bar.
Yeah.
Like, Sasha's in it.
Yeah, yeah. You don't even know she's there.
But if you watch, and you might pick Sasha, I probably would.
Oh no, you know me, Murphy and Corbin. Dominic wins this week for worst Mysterio outfit. He gets the award. It's a gay fuchsia turtleneck he's wearing. Corbin brings out two helpers, which they don't say who they are. And these helpers attack Dom and Mysterio, who are ringside. Murphy chases them into the ring and catches End of Days, and Corbin wins. This is that Forgotten Sons, guys? Is this who they are?
I had to look it up, but yeah, I didn't recognize them.
I mean, I knew that one was Murphy's former tag partner, old Buddy. Not Buddy. He's Buddy. Blake.
Wesley.
Yeah.
Wesley Blake, yeah.
Yeah, so it was weird. He kept looking at the camera, too. Did you notice that? He kept on, like, looking aside, like, look, I'm on TV. And he's with, what's her name? Sarah Lee from Tough Enough. Okay.
Sarah Lee?
Remember Sarah Lee, the one who won Tough Enough? The one little, she looked like a little farmer girl. She was very cute. She got pregnant by him, and boom, she's gone. Street Profits yammer in the back. Rude shows up. Cesaro show up. This is very fucking annoying. More tweets for Pat. And now we get Uso versus Owens and Otis because Roman doesn't show up for a while. He shows up late. Roman goes and beats the shit out of Otis on the outside, pretty much taking him out of the match. Gets in the ring because Kevin Owens is about to beat Uso. And so he starts choking him out, and they call for the bell. Uso and Roman then kill KO with the chairs, and then Roman kills Uso, and having to scold him for, you know, teaching him a lesson, which I do love this whole thing where it's like he stays with him, see what you make me do to you, and he beats the shit out of his own friend, you know, his own person, and then they'll be still together. There's no, like, him breaking away from this.
No, and that's the thing. They tried to do something similar like that with Roman and Drew on Raw, where it's like they can fight, but they're still friends. And this isn't Sheamus friendship. Like, Sheamus and Drew. This is very weird because, like, this is a bit far-fetched from when Uso was fighting against him and not giving up, and now he's just subservient to him.
Mm-hmm.
The reluctance of Uso wanting to be in this is gone. Now he's just out there by himself, like, promoting Roman. It seems to have switched a bit too quickly, I think, would be my only criticism of this, because it was one thing and now it's something completely different, where he's like almost a suck up and then trying to get his approval and then he's like beating him up. If they started like this without the match, it would make more sense. But it's a little bit weird to start how you started it and to be doing this now. But, I mean, the rest of it's all good. I mean, it's entertaining, like TV, so there's no point complaining about it.
We are on to Raw at this point. That's the end of SmackDown. It's tribute time. Another 10-bell salute for the most famous man in creative. Hogan.
Yeah, this is where I have a problem with it now.
Go for it. Go. What you explained on here.
Okay, well, he was in creative, primarily, like Vince Russo was in creative, and obviously he's Vince McMahon's friend, right? Which we know, but that doesn't mean anything to us. Like, I've only seen this guy on TV though. So this guy was on TV in the late 70s, early 80s with the Intercontinental title on WWE. Regional TV at the time, WWF regional TV. So that's not a big deal. He then comes back as one of the Stooges. Behind the scenes, he's creating the Rumble. He's creating this, that, and the other. He's tidying up matches. Everybody loves him, but it doesn't mean anything to any of us. Any of that stuff that he's doing. Like, if you're an insider, then it might mean something to you. But it's just a guy who tidied up stuff. Yeah, he's very, very friendly with all the guys there, and he might mean more of them, which is where he, like, you know, got to the level of getting the 10-bell salute or having a tribute video in the first place. But having the 10-bell salute puts him above Piper and other people that have died in the company, who got mainly videos. Then he transfer over to two shows with two 10-bell salutes, which I think puts him above maybe even Eddie Guerrero, and up, who also wasn't that much of a big star.
Benoit beats him.
Benoit beats in half.
The tribute for Benoit was bigger than for Pat.
Okay, yeah, but that's an existing like talent at the time who they feel like died whilst he was working for them. So like they're paying tribute because all the TV people are familiar with him at the time, and he was an ex-champion. Yeah, but Eddie got like a whole show as well. They had the Eddie Guerrero show, mm-hmm. they had the Owen Hart show, they had the Benoit show. But these people died while they were there. They had a show. The only one that died and he wasn't and didn't get a whole show was Pillman, who also got the 10 bell salute.
That's true.
But aside from like people not being there, I think Piper was. I don't remember if Piper had a 10 bell salute. I don't think he did. Do you think he did? I don't think he did. I can't remember.
Had to. No. Oh, man, you know what? You're probably right. It was probably that little black circle.
I think there was videos.
Yeah.
There was videos for Piper. There was videos for Randy Savage. I think Warrior may have got the 10 bell salute because he died the week before he was on Raw, and then he died. So totally he may have got it.
Yeah.
So they're very weird up and down with this. But Warrior didn't extend over to SmackDown. So if we're morbidly looking ahead at future deaths or maybe on the horizon, Flair, Hogan, Bret, maybe, you know, next 10, 15 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
Got to fucking go across two shows. You got to, like, make the show about them. Like, when Hulk Hogan dies, the next Raw has to be the 10 bell salute, all Hogan matches on the show, no wrestling, and people talking about Hulk Hogan. Right, because if this is the bar for Pat, when Hogan dies, when Flair dies, and Flair wasn't even a big WWE guy, and I always get pissy about that, where people are like, oh, he's in my Rushmore, he's in my top 10. What, for wrestling or for WWE? Because in the WWE, he ain't in no top 10 or even top 20 list.
Mm-hmm.
He had a quick run in 92 to 92, 93. He didn't make that much money. Left because, you know, the company said they were going to be dropping him down. As part of the youth movement, he left. He comes back in 2001. He's commissioner with Vince. He ends up losing that because he loses to Vince. Then he's in a jobber role before he gets into Evolution, where he's mostly a manager. And after that, he comes out, starts wrestling again, jobber role. And then he puts his career on the line, starts winning, and then gets retired. That's not Hall of Fame. Mm-hmm. Career just for WWE. That's just a very average WWE run and a very low-ranking WWF champion who held it from Rumble to WrestleMania, which is the shortest run you could have back in that era. And then he won it on a TV taping from Randy Savage and lost it on a house show to Bret Hart a few months apart.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a top run. That's not a good run. They're not good runs. It's not good WWF run. So, but because of the whole wrestling big picture thing, and now WWE and WCW are one, he needs to get a decent tribute show. And Hulk Hogan, who is WWE, would need to get the whole fucking show. And Bret as well needs to sit somewhere in the middle. This is what they've set up by this. You can't just start off with a 10 bell salute on two shows and talk about it all through a show and do a tribute match. And do he had the videos. He had the mini videos. He had the two 10 bell salutes. He had everything that was possible for a guy that was working backstage, who meant a lot to the company and Vince McMahon personally. So if this is what you're doing and then you don't get the same for Hogan and Flair, all you're essentially saying is, this is my company. This is my toy. Fuck you. I'll do what I want. I'll put what I want on here. Because this really, truly is the Vince McMahon show. And everyone that goes out there is to entertain me. And everything that I want to see is what you see on TV. And it just so happens to be some other people watching along and doing it.
Do you think that it's only on both shows because he happened to die before SmackDown? And if he had died on Saturday or Sunday, that... they would have still shown the tweets and stuff like that, but not the full 10 bell and people standing on stage on both shows.
No.
Okay.
No, I think that...
they're doing this no matter what on both shows.
Yeah, we've heard for years. Like, we've heard for years. It's understandable. It's like Vince and Pat. Pat's been the beginning. Pat's been there. Pat, I mean, this guy's there at WrestleMania 1.
Mm-hmm.
He's like fucking, he's booking WrestleMania 1, right? Which
yeah.
makes sense, but.
And refereeing. But,
right, if you're going to do this, then you need to explain, you need to have a documentary on, which I'm sure they will do.
Yeah.
Explaining why this was such a big death.
Mm-hmm.
Because this was done as if it was, this, I would argue to say that because Stephanie's only been involved really since the, and Triple H, since the early 2000s, mm-hmm. Pat Patterson is the second most important person in this company throughout the, up until that period. Like, I would say more important than Bruce, mm-hmm. Russo, everybody. Like, even though, like, obviously Russo did some, like, game-changing stuff and Pritchard has been there, if Patterson was the one who, by him and Vince, concurrently booked the entire 80s by themselves, mm-hmm. and he's been with him all the way through the 90s, and he was moved on to laying out matches. And we know when Vince allowed more people in, creative Russo, Corner, etc., Pat was still there. But if Pat's then role mainly evolved into finishes, and that's why all the wrestlers, you know, still love him in the 90s and 2000s, overall, he becomes the overriding second most important person behind Vince behind the scenes. But you've got to tell us that. Like, to Austin, like, you know, my son Austin, and or anybody else watching this, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's just a case of, oh, what did this guy do? Like, you know, sure. you expect him to go, oh, you know, he was this, he was that. Like Bruno stuff. You know, when Bruno died,
yeah.
you know, this guy is the first champion for 6 years or whatever. But it's like, oh, yeah, he was a first Intercontinental champion for a bit. And then he was a stooge. he was in the stooges. Why, how is that, like, warrant all of this? Well, actually, wait a second, because there's a documentary here on the network that tells you how he was the second most important. No, it's not, doesn't exist. It ain't there.
Yeah.
It's not there, and it didn't do a job. Oh, it didn't do a good job of it on TV either. So I obviously, for me, that's absolutely no brainer. Like, that'll be out in the next
few
weeks.
Oh, yeah, it's got, yeah, for sure.
But it's just, it comes after the show.
So Orton is in the ring. Firefly Funhouse on the Titantron. Orton says he wants a match tonight with Bray, not the Fiend. And Bray says, okay, no problem. Asuka versus Shayna. Lana and Nia Jax at ringside. Lana is walking down to the ring like a moron.
Did you see this?
Yes.
Did you know?
It did. And I was seeing that she was almost trying to mouth her music, but didn't know the fucking lyrics. And she's pointing around and doing her little, you know, walk, like she's trying to be just like Asuka here. And Nia is right. She does not belong here. And they say how you're going to, you know, they're going to twist her around. And they make a big deal about this where Nia goes, so her boobs are going to be on her back. Okay. Nia tries to powerbomb Lana onto the desk again. And it turns into a here Karana. So Jax goes flying into the desk. Asuka rolls up, distracted Shayna, and wins. Dana, stop me anytime you have anything about these things, by the way. Otherwise, I'm rolling through what is happening because I don't know. There'll be parts to discuss otherwise. Dana and Ricochet are trying to talk in the back and fake game plan, a strategy. And they're interrupted by Riddle, who has bro nuts.
So now here's where
poor
I put
Riddle.
My notes.
Poor Riddle.
That we should look at the acting here in comparison to people that can act at the top of the show, which is Owens and Roman. And then you're looking at these guys trying to do their acting, which was basically Dana and Ricochet talking about strategy, but they're doing like the hand stuff, you know, with making that like that. But you know where you like use your hands to describe something
sure.
when you're like, and this is it. This is their acting. It's talking and moving your hands and making like hand gestures out in front of you. This is their acting in terms of like trying to convey that you're strategizing a match. And then fucking idiot comes over and tries to interrupt with a fucking box of Dunkin' Donuts, which has been taped over it, and it says bro nuts on it in pen.
I feel bad for Riddle. My God, what the fuck?
And here and then Ricochet says, like, yeah, if you don't mind, we're like trying to play for a match. And then he goes, Boehner, and he offers her to donate. She's like, no, I'm trying to stop. What?
My God.
It's like, I don't understand who writes this stuff. It can't be them being told, or is it? Is it just they're so out of touch with, or that they're so trying to deliver what the company want? Because this cannot be them in a case of they're going, right, you guys are going to be strategizing a match. Matt Riddle's going to come over, and he's going to try and, what was he trying to give them, a donut?
Yeah, just give them donuts.
You're strategizing a match, and he's going to come over and try and give you a donut, but you don't want a donut. Off you go. And this is what they came out with. Like, this is nowhere near mm-hmm. natural how it would naturally go. I'm sure that in real life, if he came over as a human being and they were like planning out something, even if it's like planning out, not strategy, but say for example, let's take this into a real life situation, right? They're planning their match, but not like a strategy, like fake wrestling stuff. Mm-hmm. They're planning their match as in like, you know, their spots, sure. Like where you need to be, what we, so they're really planning their match, and Matt Riddle comes over and he really like goes and offers them the donut. Wouldn't that be like more of a, in real life, like, wouldn't there be like real life banter between them? Like, wouldn't it be like a real life conversation and how that would actually go? Wouldn't there be a way that looks real, like a real situation that would present itself? Wouldn't that actually be funny?
Yeah.
It's done completely human.
Because they could go multiple ways. Either they could be like, oh, thanks, and just shoot the shit about normal life, or be like, I'm not now, I'm busy. What the fuck are you coming up to me with fucking donuts for? I'm planning my fucking match.
No, I'm sure that there would be a real life conversation. Now, I'm not saying it would be fucking riveting, but I'm saying like, if this is a documentary and you're really backstage and they're really planning their match and Matt Riddle really comes over with some like donuts, like, and you know, we're capturing this because this is the thing, right? All of this backstage shit, which has creeped into the show like so much over the last 10, 15 years, mm-hmm. it was supposed to be like Third Eye. It was mm-hmm. supposed to be like, who's filming this, right?
Yeah.
It was always supposed to be like, oh, the camera's captured
not
this.
There, yeah.
It's like that anymore at all. It just looks like fucking scripted bullshit. It's like, if you're over there and you're going, excuse me, yeah, we're trying to strategize for the match, then why is the fucking first guy standing there holding a camera then? Why doesn't he have to go? Because this was always supposed to be like Third Eye. And now it's turned into like bits that are all in the show, like always interspersed in there. Like it's all these fucking bits. Like you don't go into the fucking UFC dressing room and like the coach is there giving him his strategy. You don't go into like a football, like when they take a timeout. We still don't have cameras there. Mm-hmm. Like talking about the fucking planning out the play. Like,
yeah.
It still doesn't happen. So why has this Third Eye become an absolutely interspersed into like throughout the show? And then it's right fucking there. It's like, and they don't even start talking until it gets to them. It's just fucking trash. It's the trash that has become synonymous with this show. I don't want to harp on this point. I'm just going to make an overall point. If you take this show and take bits of it over the like past 15, 20 years, it hasn't changed at all. If you look at the show from just 88 to 89, it changes. 89 to 90, it changes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, 90 to 1993 looks totally different. 93 to 98 looks completely different. There's different bits that they add. Like sometimes they, from the backstage, from, you know, those goofy promos where it's like, oh, we'll go to the studio and someone cuts the promo with their background, you know, with their like their logo in the background, right? You remember? Mm-hmm. Like,
yeah. Saturday Night Main Events.
In the 90s, yeah, with the music playing. In the 90s, then we had, we mixed up, we have Mean Gene in the back. In the 90s, we had Face to Face, you know, where we had things that were set up in the studios. Mm-hmm. Shawn Michaels, Heartbreak Hotel, the King's Court. You know, this similar stuff, but it was all like broken down. But over the years, I mean, in the Attitude Era was the very start of where we had that thing where shows would start with people with a guy coming down just to talk in a ring. But now there's been nothing, no development at all in the last like 20 years. It's like they found, honestly, they think they found the perfect fucking format. We're going to do our in-rings. We're going to do matches that go through breaks. We're going to go backstage and we're going to have these like third eye segments, you know, where we catch people, like we're going to set stuff up backstage. Mm-hmm. We have worked everything out. We've found the perfect show and we don't need to change anything now. We toyed around through the 80s and 90s and then in the 2000s somewhere, we landed on this perfect shit. And we're just going to iron it and roll this out every single week.
You notice the two times they've done like what, GTV and then that Ali thing, they never had it like turn into something or have an explanation. Like Ali just goes, that's me, months later. Like there's no, it's like we need to get away from it and we have no other way to do anything other than just say something and move on. So
yeah, they never paid any of that off.
No. And I'm like, GTV was, I don't know, was that Gold Dust? Originally, I thought it was supposed to be a guy from the school I went to named Vic Grimes because he was Key was his name, and he dressed in all white, and you saw him one time, like on Heat. I guess he was supposed to be like a Coke dealer. I heard that was for him at one point. So they don't know what the fuck's going on. Let's roll through this and not be a smart wrestling fan with a 6-hour show for a 3-hour show. Dana and Ricochet versus Mia Yim and Slapnuts. Dana pins Mia again, or whatever the hell her name is, Car Antenna. And that's my favorite when Conan called car radio. Ali yells at Mia Yim. They're working on getting her out of this trash gimmick as far as I could tell. Do you agree?
Yeah, I mean, last week her face got revealed anyways.
Yeah, which was great. I was wondering if she was going to come out with that mask on or not, actually. So, Miz TV, they make fun of Sheamus and Drew. Everybody gets in a fucking fight, setting up a match for later in the evening. Kofi and Benjamin, they have a match. Kofi wins, and Alexander goes in the ring and screams and says he wants a match now with Kofi, right after he finished the match already. And it's weird when Alexander screams. Do you notice how weird his voice gets? When he's like, he turns like high-pitched or something when he's like screaming.
I thought he was his voice, yeah.
Yeah, it is odd. Alexander beats Kofi and celebrates with Hurt Business. Maybe this is the end of this whole weird storyline that is supposedly a storyline. Styles, Miz, and Morrison versus Drew and Sheamus. So this is a 3-on-2. Sheamus hits Drew by accident, and then AJ pins Sheamus on the distraction. They keep on doing the, you're going to turn on him. You're going to turn on him. Keith Lee went and said, you're going to turn on him. And so, you know, they're pushing you one way because you originally thought that. So now it's kind of creeping in the opposite way of he's not going to. Okay. So in back, Drew confronts Sheamus about, you know, getting kicked in the face. And he says, Sheamus is like, you know, that was an accident. So I like that they treat it like that's how you would in real life. I mean, come on. You fucking know I didn't try to kick you. Like in wrestling where it's you fucking hit me and you're like, obviously, this is a clear accident. Watch the tape. You fucking know it's an accident. So, you know, and then being friends, it's you know this was fucking an accident. And they're hot from losing in the first place. So when they come back from commercial, they're beating the shit out of each other. And I go, okay, I actually like this because it wasn't a turn-on situation. And this is how they can get to where they need to go to have a match. Okay, this made sense to me. All of a sudden, Pat Buck gets in the way of this fight, and they beat the shit out of him instead. And they do the whole, you know, Celtic deal where, you know, they're fighting friends, and they say, let's go get a pint. And they're buddies, so they could have a fight and be friends with each other. What do you think about this?
Yeah, that's what that is. What it is. It's basically this is their interpretation of British people who like to go out and get drunk, and they can fight each other in bars and and just forget about it the next day. I think they tried to do something similar with by saying this is what like APA were. I mean, they never fought each other. I'm trying to think. There was some a group that there was people that fought each other, and they enjoyed fighting.
In where
was in it? Has this not been done before? Where groups of where people enjoyed fighting each other?
Yeah, I mean, if they're taking off a Fight Club type of stuff.
Yeah, but I'm sure. I think a company had done it before. I just don't remember it. Where there were people that enjoyed. I think it was Terry Funk and Mick Foley. I think that was it.
Mm.
They enjoyed fighting Chainsaw Charlie time.
Yeah. Hardy versus Bobby Lashley, non-US title. Lashley wins this, pretty much beats the shit out of Hardy. And Riddle is like hanging out with Hardy now.
Yeah, I mean, this is trying to be like Matt and Jeff, isn't it? Because that's what they are. Because they tried to do this. I reported they were going to do this before.
I thought it was them being stoners together, or that now Jeff has to be the counsel for Riddle and tell him drugs are bad. Okay.
Exactly.
Orton versus Bray now, and this is the only time. It's good that there's no audience because they can do stuff if they want to. They don't have to hold to the rules, which means Orton is about to win this match. The lights start to go out and he RKOs Bray, who's, you know, in his Mr. Rogers outfit because he's Bray. And he goes for the pin. The lights go out. When they turn back on red, Bray is laying in the ring now as the Fiend and then fucking starts choking out. Orton. I enjoy this. I enjoy this because if you have to be in this circumstance where you don't have the audience and all that, you might as well start doing shit that you can get away with at this point. And because once it's over with, you know, in 10 years from now when we have audience again, we're not going to be able to do this.
No. I mean, I thought he might have got changed really quick, but he could have been
he fucking real fast, like fucking Superman in a phone booth. But that is how Raw ends. I wasn't riveted, obviously, as I was doing my half-assed notes while I was setting up this fucking Roadcaster Pro, baby. So
here's the last thing I wanted to say about it. While I reach for something I just dropped down the side of my bed. I'll have to get it after. Here's the thing. What happened at the end of Raw was something that we've continuously done with The Fiend, where he did that thing with John Cena where he was out in the crowd and in the ring. Do you remember? Where Cena saw him in the crowd and then the
yes.
lights went out.
Yeah.
So that's a use of the Performance Center, and this is a use of the Thunderdome, because what people don't understand is that the people that are watching the Thunderdome, they're not watching from there. I'll explain this to Austin, and I'm trying to explain it in a way where he understood.
So yeah, some people don't understand this, which is odd to me, but go ahead.
You're not watching. That's not your seat view, right? So if you're at the top of the Thunderdome or you're ringside in the Thunderdome, you're not seeing the ringside view.
Yeah.
Whereas if you're higher up, you're not getting a higher view. That's like what people think, and that's how WWE made it look.
Yeah.
What you see
is the TV.
Is this episode of Raw on your laptop.
Yeah.
And that's literally all that happens. What was interesting is that if you watch this like switchover that they did with Fiend in there, they won't go to the TV screens because they wouldn't have had the people in there at the time, would they?
Yeah.
Right, because obviously unless you're recording these people and then you just flashed up different, whatever, I don't know how they got around it, but it wouldn't have been live. It's not live to the second. What they do is they put the screens on and Raw is all live, but they can do whatever they want because what the people on the screen are seeing is the episode of Raw. So if you're staying at ringside and they go backstage, the segment that comes up on your TV is backstage. You're not watching it through...
Looking up at the screen, yeah.
Looking up at the Titantron. Like, you're not seeing them changing the ropes or sweeping the ring or or whatever. Like, not like a real show.
You're watching commercials.
Yeah, you're watching commercials. Like, so this is how the Thunderdome works. So that's the thing a lot of people don't understand. Now, here's what I wanted to say after seeing this. Would you not put up a whiteboard, right?
Mm-hmm.
And put in the center of the whiteboard and say, things we can do whilst we are not live.
Yeah.
And like, and then basically then circle around it and then put like brainstorming ideas off it.
Sure.
And then do every one of them. Because the only way that you make anything good out of this period is to shoot like TV that is not reliant on a live audience. Because sometimes you cannot do things. Like sometimes like when you put something on TV and you think, oh, this is going to take a live audience out for like 30 minutes or whatever, like the Boneyard match would have done.
Yeah.
You'd never be able to do that at WrestleMania normally because you would have people watch. We would ideally not like to do something put on the TV screen and take the audience out for like 40 minutes. But here it works. So you need to be looking now at the most entertaining things that you can do with this TV time to be like, okay, so that at least there's some resemblance of people going, okay, so that was a shit time in wrestling. Like 2020 was bad, but
innovation.
I missed that they did this. I missed that they did that. You have to change this too. It was bad, but they did all those things. At the moment, it'd be like, oh yeah, it was bad, but oh, you can do this thing where the Fiend, where Mr. Rogers changes into the Fiend, or Bray Wyatt comes in from the audience. He was in the audience, and then a second later, he was next to Cena.
Yeah.
All right. I should have like 50. I should just be paraphrasing this down to, oh, it wasn't the best time in wrestling, but what about all them things that they did that they don't do that they can't normally do in a TV show? Like, what about all of those face-to-face interviews that we did? Or this, you know, just 100. I'm not going to make the show longer by brainstorming ideas, but like, would you not be brainstorming ideas by having, 10, 15 things that you can do on these shows? But you would it doesn't matter about the live crowd. In fact, wouldn't you? I would almost go like 50% of it doesn't happen in the ring because you don't have to put a show on for these people anymore.
It's like Boneyard match. They could have. I mean, they started, so we thought that was going to happen. I mean, it's like they could do Boneyard match, that final deletion type of stuff. We got a barroom brawl thing. I mean, they could do a lot more of this, and they could also, like you said, have a little. Like 15-minute segments of interviews where they're at their home even doing. So it's not as, like, to me, it's almost like when the show is on, it's background noise because it's the same. It just blends in. I don't need to pay attention. With that, I would literally stop to watch if there was like an interview at someone's home. It would be because it's different. And I'm like, well, this must mean something because it's not something I'm seeing all the time.
No, and then that's the other thing. Like, even just this small shit. I remember, like,
Brett and Sean training. Remember that whole deal?
Brett and Sean training. But I remember he used to have videotapes where they would do, like, DIY with the Bushwhackers, or they would do yoke. Mean Gene would go for, he would go to the restaurant with Mr. Fuji and Yokozuna, and Mr. Fuji was telling him how much how he ate this every day. And there was a guy there cooking rice on a hot plate, and cutting up chicken on a hot plate and fish. And it was fucking brilliant. It was, and there's loads of shit like that you can ham up from old WWE episodes of, primetime wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
This is your time to bring back the stupid shit with Gene and Bobby and all that kind of stuff, and not make it as like hokey. I think they even tried this where they had the Street Profits and people playing mini golf and basketball and all that shit okay, that was the right way to go, but it certainly wasn't right in its execution. And maybe they like executed so poorly that now they don't want to go back there.
Yeah.
But there are a way to do these things right, like bringing better people, bringing like non-wrestling people to shoot some shit. Like you could go into the background of Drew and Sheamus. You can find out, like, you do individual bits in terms of like find out who these people are, like behind the scenes. You could even fucking take a camera down and let's see this fucking wrestling that Lana is learning. Instead
yeah.
of me find a documentary about Liv and Lana on the network, like put the stuff onto TV. Mm-hmm. Like maybe people would actually have a shred of sympathy and give one iota of a shit about Lana if we were having to force ourselves through a documentary on a network. Like do something for the actual TV show, because this is the thing that most people are watching. And this is the worst. Your network documentaries, be it with Taker, Lana, Liv Morgan, and everything, should not be telling better stories than your TV. Like the Liv thing, I don't give a fuck about Liv Morgan, but I watched like 45 minute show on her. It's really good.
Yeah, they do fucking great when they do these extra shows. Their production has always been fucking great. It's their storytelling now that's fucking horrible.
That Liv documentary and that Lana documentary cut, instead of being a documentary for the network, if that was cut into, like, say it's an hour, right?
Mm-hmm.
Say you could fit like 10 segments out of it, and you could like air 6 minutes of Lana 3 times a week. That means you get 3 weeks of TV out of that documentary, and you fill 20 minutes for the next 3 weeks. And bearing in mind the actual airtime of the show is 2 minutes and 10, right? That's what happens after commercials. You get 2 minutes and 10. 20 minutes of that would have been Lana for 3 weeks, and you could do the same for Liv on SmackDown. And I know people are thinking, I don't fucking want to watch that on Lana. Well, you will.
Yeah, because they make it interesting, for sure.
Right.
Yeah, and from minutes. What the hell we're watching now, yeah, you will watch that.
Of course you will. You watch her, like, crying. I mean, she's on there crying about, she's going through, like, a social media and crying and stuff, even though she brings it on herself completely. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it's still more watchable. Even if you think, fucking hell, like, you bring this, you deserve it, which I do. You still watch it. You'll still watch her crying about it.
Yeah.
Over trying to wrestle.
All right.
Anyway,
that is the end of the wrestling show, where we give you all the rundown right after, the morning after, it all happens. I get up at 4 a.m. for you motherfuckers to do this fucking show. Where can we find all your nonsense, Billy, other than DirtySheets.com?
DirtySheets.com is my Twitter. TheDirtySheets.com is my Patreon page. I need to start putting more content up for that. We will do as we get towards WrestleMania. It's such a dead period. Like a few people left this week, but I mean, there's not much going on. But this period coming up is the busiest. And lockbetting.com is where all of my betting stuff is. The best time to sign up is now at the start of the month, because this is where we're coming towards the end of the NFL season. And all this, there's loads of soccer as well. We absolutely killed our NFL show this week. So listen to this week's show, which is out tomorrow. And of course, Podcast on a Pole just recorded the newest episode. The thing still exists where if you leave reviews for Podcast on a Pole and the Dirty Sheets, I will be giving out a signed figure. So I'll be drawing out like the first one on the... Let's just make a date here to do this. What am I going on Russo's show? I don't think me and Russo are going to work Christmas Day. Maybe we will. I don't know. But to be safe, in case we don't work Christmas Day, on the 18th of December, I will draw out like the first person who wins a figure for leaving a review on the Dirty Sheets or on Podcast and Apollo. If you leave a review for both,
there's got to be at least 10 to be able to do that.
Yeah, I'm not doing it until there's a certain amount. Yeah.
Okay, good. And I'll give you the names on the American side, because you can't see those.
Yeah, exactly. So I'll put the American side together for Podcast on a Pole or the Dirty Sheets. And if you do both, you get in twice. And you stay in forever. Like, you stay in for till the end of Podcast on a Pole, which is 3 years.
Yeah.
So you'll goes in there forever. You'll have two names in the hat for the rest of the time the show exists if you leave your reviews now. And at the moment, like as Cav said, like we're not going to do it till we get to 10, but the early one is the best one to do because like there's probably any names in there at the moment because people don't seem to be listening to me.
Yeah, you might get eventually when the show is really fucking known. You know, there's a thousand people, so you know.
But if you leave 2 stars like Joe Negron of Smart Wrestling Fan, won't even be entered. It has to be 5 stars.
Yeah. Yeah. It's you gotta fucking get in that way. You can't go, this fucking show sucks, and then get into a draw.
What about mental patient? What about the mental patient? The mental guy.
If anybody wants to hear here's a little tidbit for everybody. On the Lingus Mafia podcast, for the Freebirds, it will be up on Thursday. For the people who have my Patreon, patreon.com/LingusMafia, you will get the show tonight. I am going to fucking destroy somebody from Twitter. And I'm going to give orders to people on Twitter. All of my fucking, the family of the Lingus Mafia will be having their crosshairs on this fucking lunatic mental patient fucking geek. And I'm going to fucking slay this pig. He will have an apple in his mouth, Billy, after this is over with. Because this pig will be fucking spit roasted. It's amazing. The man is a fucking mental. And he's going to get fucking dealt with tonight. So that's just a side piece for you people. If you want to hear the full story, either sign up. It's $10 on Patreon. If you want the full show, obviously, every week, plus bonus shows, multiple shows during the week. If you want just the Lingus Mafia main show on time on Tuesday, it's only $3 a month. All the other stuff is $10 because you get like 3 shows practically every week, sometimes more. So, go ahead.
I'll hold till next week's show because I'm just going to wait. See how I don't want to give the guy 2 weeks of attention.
No.
So I'm going to wait and see how this plays out first this week.
Yeah, because you're going to see something. All my people, look at my Twitter, and you will see all the replies when I've said I have a hit to put out. Everybody's ready. All the GIFs are people loading guns. Arnold getting ready, putting, you know, knives in his fucking wallets and pockets and all this shit. So that'll be that. So go check out at Lingus Mafia. For Mr. Billy Body, I am Kevin Manning. We're out of time. Touch.